This is a very special book to me. This is my grandfather's Latin dictionary. And when I was 7 years old, I loved to visit my grandfather. He was a medical doctor and he lived in a big white villa. And in his basement, he had hundreds and hundreds of books. So when I would go down that basement, I would go down a curly stairs, which was full of spider webs. And downstairs, it was dark and dusty and it smelled musty. And all the walls were covered with books. So I would look at the titles, I would look at the covers, and I would open the books that I was allowed to. And that would bring me to a distant reality of dreams and imagination. Now, there was this bottom section with books behind glass, and that's where I found this book. And I brought it upstairs, and I sat on the couch with my grandfather, and I opened it, and one of the first words that I recognized was the word philosophus. And my grandfather explained me what is the meaning of the word and what is its etymology. And I believe that was one of the first sparks of a desire for intellect and discovery. Now, I also found encyclopedias, and I would read them at night before going to sleep. And I would read about these great inventors who made such an impact on the world as we know it today, like James Watt, Isaac Newton, or Galileo Galilei. And I would dream that maybe one day I would also make such a contribution and maybe also be in an encyclopedia. Now, the morning after, I would wake up in the social housing neighborhood where I lived with my mom, who was 26 years old and divorced, and my sister, who was 3 years older. And we didn't have much. We would buy secondhand clothing, and often at the end of the month, we didn't have food in the house. We would eat rice with sugar. Now, you probably wonder how my grandfather lived in a villa and my mom in social housing, but there is something in the Netherlands which is sacred. It's called Selfreliance. So I lived in this house, and it was like a brick cube with a pitched roof, and all the houses were attached to each other, and all the window frames were the same, and the doors were the same, and they even had the same color of paint. And as far as you could walk, all those houses were the same. And I loved to be outside, and I would visit neighbors and other people in the street, but that would also expose me to what was happening behind these doors. And I saw a lot of family problems as a young kid, and I saw problems like poverty and neglect, alcohol abuse, family fights, and as a kid, you accept everything that you see and get to know for the first time. But as a young kid, I already understood that life is not always fair and sometimes not even safe. But when you do have everything, there's actually this opportunity of self-development and discovery. And later I realized that that was actually one of the first parts of a foundation of my later invention, PowerNest. Now, I was a curious kid, and my parents got back together again, and that didn't all go too smooth, and there were a lot of fights at home, and I didn't like to spend too much time at home. So I was outside wandering the streets from the morning till the evening. And a few years later, we moved to a small town under Maastricht. And I remember the first day in class, and the teacher introduced me. And she introduced me as the kid from the big city. And I thought, that must be something really cool. That's a good start. But actually, the opposite was true, because in this small town, being different was not at all appreciated. And I felt like I was in a judgmental, suppressive environment where I was being kept small. And over the years that I lived there, and my home situation wasn't pleasant, outside wasn't pleasant, I slowly lost touch with my curiosity. And I lost touch with my dreams and the the eagerness to invest in myself. And that actually had an impact on me as well, because I became rebellious and I started to have low grades at school, and up to a certain point that the teacher talked to my parents and said, well, maybe it's better to prepare your kids for his education to become a construction worker, just like his dad. And this went on for years, and I even got kicked out of high school at a certain point, and I ended up at a community college, preparation for construction. And I remember I was sitting in the physics class, and I was sitting all the way in the back, and I was in a class full of zero motivated people. And we got our exams back, and I was looking at it, and it was shamefully bad. And at a certain point, I look up, and the teacher was standing in front of me, in front of my desk. And he wasn't a tall guy, but he had this posture like a bear. And he looked at me, and he said, Mr. Suma, I know you can do much better. And from now on, you're going to sit front row. You won't score lower than an 8 out of 10, or I'll kick your ass. And that made such an impact on me. And it was in front of the whole class, and it felt like I removed this heavy blanket of self-doubt and giving up. And that all made place for engagement and empowerment, and I reconnected with my curiosity. So the immediate proof of it, I didn't score lower than an 8 out of 10. I graduated really well, and I could move on to do a bachelor in structural engineering. I said goodbye to the old friends who had a bad influence on me, and I actually graduated with a 10 out of 10 for my bachelor thesis, and I even made it in the newspaper. And I wanted more. So I moved on to do a Master of Structural Engineering at the Eindhoven University of Technology. And there I found a mentor who showed a great interest in my ideas and gave me books that I should read to develop my ideas more. And I started to create an interest in architecture. And I started to do Master of Architecture simultaneously. And I graduated for both masters with a 9 out of 10. I won several design awards. I won 2 thesis awards. And I even won a world record. And I wasn't done yet. So I applied for a scholarship at the University of Miami. And I got it. And there again, I found a mentor who supported me and gave me the trust and freedom to work on my own ideas and projects. And one of those ideas is actually what I would like to tell you. And it was in the first year of my PhD that I was walking one morning to the university, and it's this long street crossing several blocks, and on both sides, these typical Miami bungalows with grass in front of them and palm trees on the side. And it was already bloody hot, and it was only 9 in the morning. So I was walking, and every house I passed, I heard the AC, the air conditioning fan, running. And at the same time, the sun was burning in my neck, and the wind was blowing in my face from the morning breeze. And I thought, wow, Miami is so rich of energy resources, and nobody is making use of them. Later that day, I was sitting in a class, and the class was kind of boring, so I was dreaming, and I thought, what if we could place something on buildings that can exchange all its energy from its direct environment? And I started sketching, and very quickly I came up with an idea, and I designed a turbine in the middle and funnels towards it to direct the wind, and in an architectural way, the solar panels integrated on top. And I did some calculations, and it turned out to be a real efficient system. And I heard about this conference in Hawaii where I could win a travel award, so I made this poster. And I was lucky because a few weeks before, I was sitting in a lunch and I was sitting next to the vice provost of technology transfer. And he was a really nice guy and he gave me his business card. So I called him and I said, I have this idea and this poster, can I show this to you? And he says, sure, come this afternoon. So I took my motorcycle, I went on the I-95 to the medical campus, and there was this hospital-like building, and I found the elevator, went up to the 9th floor, and I found his office, and there he was standing in the middle of the office in this white coat, this doctor's coat. And he had a big desk and a view over the city. And I showed him my poster, and he didn't say anything. But he went to the phone, and he called the director of the department and the patent attorney, told them to come, and they came, and he locked the door. And he came to me and he said, Mr. Suma, is this your idea? And did you share this with anyone? And I said, yes, this is my idea. I designed this and I made the poster. And he said, well, you have to promise me that you will not share this with anyone, nor what's being said in this room, not even with your mom. And within 5 years, you're going to be a millionaire. I still have to give him a call about that. But he and his team coached me and supported me. And from an engineering PhD student, I was 3 weeks later pitching for angel investors on a big stage. And there was a team of professors working on my idea instead me on theirs, usually. And I even met with Governor Christ, who told me that for the first time in his life, he was asked to sign a non-disclosure agreement to see my idea. Now, this all happened in 2009. And back then, there was no solid ground for renewable energy or sustainability to become a success in the United States. But in Europe, we were already doing a lot of research. So I went back to Europe, and we immediately received grants from the Dutch government, from the European government, and we won award after award. Now, there's been quite some years between my first sketch and where we are today. And there have been many people who said small wind turbines, rubbish, wind on roofs, wind in cities is never going to work. But guess what? Because me and my team, we created something that can generate all the electricity that a building needs for medium and high-rise buildings to make them net zero energy. And it even looks good. And I call it Power Nest. A Power Nest is a fully modular, integrated energy rooftop that generates all its electricity from wind and solar in the winter and in the summer. And we were able to create the highest efficient system at this moment in the world by enhancing the efficiency of the solar parts as well as the wind parts by aerodynamics. And it fits on every building of 5 levels or higher as long as it has a flat roof. Now what you see here is our latest installation in Eindhoven, the Haasje Over building, where Power Nest provides 85% of the electricity demand of this 20-story tower. And we already know how to get to 120%. And that is specifically important because we are now able to neutralize the largest energy consumers in the city, and that is important for grid congestion. Now, this is our first project, and we're already preparing the second project on the social hub tower next to the central station here in Eindhoven. And there are 7,000 buildings in the Netherlands where we can apply Power Nest, and 1,000-fold more in the rest of the world. Now, with my growing up, in my youth, I saw two different realities. One where people are poor and their mind is occupied by the challenges and the pain and the suffering and suppression. And the other one where there's wealth, freedom, independence, and there's all the space and time to develop yourself and give back to this world. Now today, there's still a lot of people who do not have access to affordable energy. While the wind and the sun are a free gift from our planet every day. So what I want to give back with Powerness to people, to this planet, is to create a solution where people have access to affordable, clean energy. Because energy is one of the most essential things that we need for a human lifestyle today. So it should not be controlled by a government or a handful of corporates. So it's my goal to bring us one step closer to less worries and provide more space and time to develop yourself, to fulfill your dreams, and to become self-empowered. Thank you.